إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. اعلموا عباد الله أن أحسن الكلام كلام الله تبارك وتعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم ما بعد، عباد الله، my dear brothers and sisters, I guess you all know by now what's going on in the Mediterranean. What is happening and what has become now as the arks of death, the boats of death, when so many people are preferring to take chances, not even 50-50, to survive or die, than living in conditions considered completely excruciating, suffering day and night. Even though, still for some, it's better than being dead. But for these people to take these chances, hoping for better conditions in life in this dunya, chances that would, in many cases, lead to deaths, and massive deaths as we see it every single day in the news. And I'm speaking to you today, and I'm speaking this moment, I'm sure, there are some of them right now, riding willingly, taking their chances in these arch and boats of death. Why? Because they lost hope in humanity. They lost hope and support from the people. They lost hope from whom? Those who are supposed to be their kinship, their brothers and sisters in faith, their brothers and sisters in humanity in the Muslim land. That's why they travel and they're taking their chances to a complete foreign land. They're taking their children, their families, babies are dying. And you've seen that in the news recently. Subhanallah, when it comes to assisting and helping the needy and the oppressed, that is a religious duty, Jama'ah. It is a religious duty. We can't just watch and see and then just all what we do is cry and do nothing. People, they ask me every single day and on the news, they ask me online, what can we do? What should I do? There is so much you could do, but unfortunately we're so distracted by the flood of information. We get so distracted in our agonies and our grief. We get so distracted crying and just kind of weeping and doing nothing. So what can we do, and where we can get this from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? I want you first to know that when it comes to assisting the needy and helping those destitute and supporting and giving help and assistance to the oppressed is indeed a religious duty. You see, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after Al-Hudaybiyah, which is the treaty that the Prophet ﷺ signed between him and the people of Mecca, one of those rules, one of those items, the provisions of that deal, is that if anyone fights or anyone attacks an ally of Muhammad ﷺ or an ally of the Quraysh people in Mecca, the deal is over. That deal of peace, 10 years between them, is over, and they have the right to retaliate and now assist their allies. So one of those knights, part of the allies in that treaty, Banu Khuza'a, they were the allies of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and their territory was near Mecca. And Banu Bakr, they entered the alliance with the people of Mecca, with the Quraysh. They had so much hostility among themselves, Banu Bakr and Banu Khuza'a, even way before Islam. So at some point, Banu Bakr, they took advantage of some sort of peace moment, and they attacked Banu Khuza'a. At night, they killed some of them, and the war was erupted. Some of the Quraysh, they aided them with military aid, with weapons, and even they fought with them against the allies of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the war certainly was over, and Banu Khuza'a, they felt how much they were betrayed by that, their leader, Amr ibn Salim al-Khuza'i, he took a journey from Mecca to Medina. That takes 7 days usually when you travel on the back of a camel. Can you imagine this man, the grief and sorrow and the anxiety he was going through just to try to arrive safely to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The grief that he was carrying with him, the grievances, the sense, the feeling of being oppressed and transgressed against by the people of Mecca and their allies, he went to his ally Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What was he hoping for? He was hoping for support. He was hoping for support. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I came here because we went in an alliance with you. So the man, when he arrived and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was in the masjid, he entered the masjid and he started with a poetry, asking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to fulfill his part of the agreement. قَالَ يَا رَبِّي إِنِّي نَاشِدُ مُحَمَّدًا. My Lord, I'm calling Muhammad right now. حِلْفَ أَبِينَا وَأَبِيهِ الْأَتْلَدَى. I'm calling him to honor the deal, to honor that agreement, the covenant between us and him, and between our forefathers, as he says. فَانْصُرْ هَدَاكَ اللَّهِ نَصْرًا أَيِّدًا. I want you, may Allah guide you, to give us that victory and that aid and that help that you promised. وَدُعْ عِبَادَ اللَّهِ يَأْتُوكَ مَدَدًا. And ask your followers and your people, they will come in great numbers to support you and to support us. إِنَّ قُرَيْشًا أَخْلَفُوكَ الْمَوْعِدًا. Quraysh, they betrayed you. They broke that deal with you. وَنَقَضُوا مِثَاقَكَ الْمُؤَكَّدًا. And they breached the covenant that you established with them. هُمْ بَيَّتُونَ بِالْوَتِيرِ. هُجَّدًا. They came and they ambushed us at night when we were praying and we were sleeping. رُكَّعًا وَسُجَّدًا. And they killed us while we were doing sujood and ruku'. وَزَعَمُوا أَلَّسْتُ أَدْعُوا أَحَدًا. And they thought that I would not be able to call anyone for help. وَهُمْ أَذَلُّ وَأَقَلُّ عَدَدًا. And I know that they're less in number and less in might than you. You know what was the answer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't give him one of those political statements you hear from the UN to the Syrian population, for example, or people. He didn't give him a long speech or poetry. He just gave him few words. Shows a leader who is really determined and he knows what he does. He said, "Qala nusirta ya Amr ibn Salim." He says, "Aid is coming, O Amr ibn Salim." Which means the help you're asking for, like he says to him, you got it. And that's all what he said. But that is a man, when he says a word, he keeps it. When he makes a promise, he fulfills that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You see, this incident and those few words that he pronounced, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were the base that changed the face of history for the world. Those are the words that provoked the conquest of Mecca. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, silently, he called upon the people to come and get ready to go out with him. Usually the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam keeps everything secret, and that was one of those secret destinations. People didn't know where they're going. They just knew that Muhammad is calling them to come and go out with him. And they came in great numbers. For the first time in the history of Islam, 10,000 people, they gathered and getting ready just for the command of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their destination was Mecca in order to aid and help this man who came asking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for help. But that was at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What was he trying to establish? What exactly was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam trying to establish? He was establishing what Allah commands, justice. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِي يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. Indeed, Allah orders justice and good conduct, and giving to relatives forbids immorality and bad conduct and oppression. He admonishes you that perhaps you will be reminded. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had the power, he had the might, he had the state sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to do that. Today, many of us in a condition like ours, they fantasize and romanticize the same reaction to be from the Muslims in the Muslim world and even America. No, we're not asking you to do that. We're asking you to look into your abilities and what you could do from whatever position you are in life. We're asking you to just to help and assist the needy and try to alleviate the suffering of those people. And if you can remove that oppression in whichever capacity you can, you should. That's what we're asking from you. And when it comes to the subject of oppression, I want you to understand that religion becomes irrelevant. The removal of this difficulty, oppression in this case, religion becomes irrelevant. You don't look into the religion of the person who's been oppressed, if he was Muslim or non-Muslim. You'd even look if this person was an enemy or not. If it's oppression, it needs to be removed. It needs to be removed, and the suffering has to be alleviated, because that is the concept of justice. See, hatta Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did that even way in Mecca before he had the power of 10,000 people to come out with him to support the people of Banu Khuza'a. He did that when he was an individual, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Mecca. He was oppressed at that time. He was doing nothing but calling people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the people of Mecca, they were harassing him. They were attacking him. They were torturing him. They were mocking him. They were doing everything possible. Everything possible to stop the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from giving his da'wah. And to discourage the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in front of the people. But he never stopped. In one of those occasions, we know from the seerah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was in Mecca sitting somewhere around the Kaaba, taking care of his own things, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. And the people of Mecca were gathered in their own, what they consider like the parliament, or the kind of the, where they sit down together to discuss matters related to the community and so on. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in that situation, and the people of Mecca were sitting in that situation, a man came, known as Al-Arashi, from a certain tribe, from Arash. He came to Mecca. He came to Mecca for business. And when he dealt with the business, he dealt with one of the tyrants of Mecca, one of the great leaders of Mecca at the time, Abu Jahl, the arch enemy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Jahl, he took that business. So basically, he kind of got the products and the items and the business of this man, and then he didn't pay him anything. So the man felt kind of oppressed at this moment. Like, come on, I'm coming to Mecca. I don't have anything with me. No, none of my people is with me around. So he goes to the people of Quraysh. And he's asking them now for help. Ya ma'ashara Quraysh. Ya ma'ashara Quraysh. Man min rajulin ya'du ala Abi Hakim ibn Hisham. He says, O people of Quraysh, who will be amongst you to help me against Abu Hakim ibn Hisham? That's Abu Jahl. Of course, Quraysh, they know he's one of them. And that's another leader amongst them. They're going to have to support each other. So they all kept quiet. However, one of them, he wanted to make a mockery out of it. So he points to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, you see this man sitting over there? They knew how much Abu Jahl hated Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they knew how difficult it would be for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to handle and deal with Abu Jahl in a matter like this. But they told him, you see the man sitting over there? And he pointed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, go and talk to him. He might help you against Abu Jahl or Abu Hakim ibn Hisham. So the man, not knowing who Muhammad was, didn't even know the background of this whole situation, he goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The man comes to Muhammad salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, faqala lahu, he told him what happened with the conversation that happened between him and Abu Jahl, and then what happened between him and Quraysh. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked the Prophet, ya Muhammad, if you could help me with that. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, af'al, I will, let's go. SubhanAllah, no hesitation. He did not even hesitate. He didn't even think of who was the, against whom is going to have this argument. But what he did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he put his trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. And he said, I'm going to do my best. And I'll go with you. That's all what he did, salawatullah wa salam alayhi. As for the results, it's in the hand of Allah Azza wa Jal. These results are in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He just did his part. He said, I'll go with you. When someone asks him for help, he would never say no. So he goes out with this man until he arrived at the house of Abu Jahl. When the people of Mecca, they saw the man walking with Muhammad, they were surprised and shocked, but at the same time entertained. Like, you know what? They send one of them, they go after them and bring to us what's going to happen. Tell us what's going to happen between Muhammad and Abu Jahl. So this man goes after them to see what's going to happen at the door of Abu Jahl. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he knocks on the door of Abu Jahl. And when Abu Jahl, he asks, who was there? Rasulullah says, Muhammad. The narrator says, when the door was open, kharaja Abu Jahl, qal wama fi wajhi qatratu dam. His face was pale. Like he was so intimidated. And he asks him, what's going on? He says, أدي هذا الرجل حقه. He just gave those few words. He says, you better pay this man his haqq, his right. They said, take care of this man. Very well. Abu Jahl, he says, لا يبرح حتى أعطيه حقه. He said, don't go and let him go until I pay him off completely. And he got in there, he gave the Prophet ﷺ, the man in front of the Prophet ﷺ, his money, and the man left. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he says, you're done, you're satisfied? He goes, I'm satisfied. And he left. The man went straight to the group, the Qurayshi, near the Kaaba. And he proudly told them what happened. I said, Jazakumullahu khayra. Like, thank you very much for what you've done. The man helped me so much. For them, that wasn't what they were expecting, right? And they were stunned by that answer. But my point here is not about this answer as much as what the Prophet ﷺ did when he was asked for help. He didn't hesitate. He didn't think about the dangers he had to go through. He thought about one thing. I'll just do my part. Results in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is exactly what we need to do. We need to be active in helping and assisting and providing and alleviating the suffering of these people and even assisting the oppressed in whichever capacity we can do. We are not asking you to do beyond what you can. But you definitely had to try and had to do your best, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. I remind myself first and foremost, and everybody here in this room, in this musalla, in this masjid, and all those are watching with us and actually listening to us, that when it comes to helping and assisting people, those who are in need, those who are oppressed, it's a religious duty. The ulama even, they call this fardu kifaya. It is fardu kifaya, which means it's a community obligation that if we don't do it while we can, we will all be considered sinful. And if we're going to always wait for someone else to do it, obviously no one will. That means each and every one of us should have that obligation on themselves to do as much as they can. And I don't have really to quote many of the ayat in the Quran, the hadith, the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ in regard to the importance of helping the others. But I would like just to share with you a few things in regard to what we can do really, what kind of assistance, what kind of help we can provide and we can give these people. Number one, intellectual support. What I mean by the intellectual support, I know most of us would think of the military support right away. But you know what? In a time, in a society, in a culture that is all information culture, subhanAllah, that the public opinion can be so powerful, even more powerful than the military machines, this is becomes a great opportunity, a great obligation in each and one and every one of us. If you are online, in whatever actually capacity you can, whether on Facebook, social media, in any way, you should always bring that up to the attention of the public opinion so that it goes up to the politician afterwards. But the first is the intellectual support that they need from you. What do you mean by intellectual support? People sometimes even they doubt that these people have the right to be supported or even to be helped. You need to bring their case out to the public so they understand what's going on in the world. Look at the example of the Palestinian situation. For all these years right now, Allah musta'an. All these years, and we're still debating with the international community, especially in the West, because they're brainwashed by the media and by the history of the conflict and so on. They don't even know that the Palestinians have right in the land that they're fighting for. Similarly, when it comes to the Syrian situation, as we see people dying in the sea, people, they would say, why would they even risk themselves? What are they doing that for? Why can't they just stay in their homes? They don't even know that they don't even have homes anymore. So how can we support them? We need to bring their case out to the public. And I'm not just limiting this to the case of the people in Syria, also the Rohingya and Burma, and anywhere else in the world, even the non-Muslim situations, anywhere in the world, we should always be participating in that. So bring that intellectual support for them. Second, the financial support. There is no doubt these people, many of them, they lost everything, literally lost everything. Therefore, they are willing to make extremely radical decisions in their lives. And in many cases, it will be the wrong decisions. It is our duty to help them, at least give them hope that they can survive. They can find another way, another outlet to this situation. So they can be relieved. It is our duty, if we can support them financially, that we should do that. Whether by sending them money, or maybe somehow finding a way that you go there and bring from through merchants and business people and so on, in the right way. Just give them that support, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Some of us always think that the support has to come through Muslim organizations. You know, in any way that is possible. Because now it's a matter of life and death for them. So this is something we need to take care of, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Next, in the media. And I say that in the media particularly because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used even the kind of media they had back then. And the most popular media back then they had was poetry. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had his own poets. Hassan ibn Thabit was one of them. And when the Hassan used to compose his poetry and he pronounces that in public, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say to him, "Inna ruh al-Qudus la yazala yu'ayyiduka ma nafahta an Allahi wa Rasulih." Ruh al-Qudus, which means Jibreel, is there for you to help you as long as you defend Allah and His Messenger. So I'm saying this to you in behalf of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to his followers, to his ummah, that if you do so, if you write, if you make a video, whatever that you do to get it out there into the media, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hopefully will send you the support of the angels, support of Jibreel, to guide you through the process and what to say and what to write. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all through this jama'ah. Also, the political aspect. We live in a society that is again influenced by public opinion. And as Muslims living in this society, we have to be active in this. I guess this community showed some, maybe we felt it a little bit back in the local elections we had over here in the city. Just that was in April and May. We have seen how much influence you can do in this society just by active participation. Imagine if we take it, inshallah, tabarakah, to the next level. Not just necessarily right now on the local level. If you go into the national, regional, and hopefully, inshallah, we'll get to the international. Do not belittle the little effort that you make. Do not do that. Just because we finished elections before, that doesn't mean that, alhamdulillah, we've done our part. No, you need to still be always vigilant and active. The opportunity that your voice can be heard in the community, locally and nationally, internationally as well. It's very crucial, very important for us to participate in that. And if you don't know, please make sure that, inshallah ta'ala, you have someone who will guide you to where we can participate in that actively. There is also the physical support. And that is something for those who are there already. These are the people who are oppressed, and their responsibility is to defend their lands in whichever capacity they can. And what we can do for them? Make a lot of dua. The support with the dua, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them victory against the oppressor. That may Allah help them. May Allah alleviate their suffering. And that's what we need to do for them. This is the least we could do. And when we make dua for them, we make it sincere and should always come from the heart. Come from the heart for victory, because this is a human crisis, a human catastrophe. And these are humans. These are now humans, not just because they're Muslims even. And that is something that we all need to think about. SubhanAllah, Allah Azza wa Jal made that the shed of one drop of blood. That is much more dangerous than knocking down the Kaaba one brick at a time, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. You can think of the amount of blood that's being shed so far in all these kind of conflicts. Whose responsibility is that? And if we don't become active, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not take us accountable for this. But wallahi, as long as we always remain silent, we're not participating as much as we can again from whichever position you are in, then we're definitely going to be counted among those who will be held accountable on Judgment Day, not being active there to help these people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to support them and help them. And I ask Allah azza wa jal to alleviate the suffering of these people. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give them victory against the oppressors. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring peace and tranquility to their lives and their hearts. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا ما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters, once again, when we talk about helping and assisting, I know most of us, alhamdulillah, are those who always take opportunities, inshallah, azza wa jal. This is the position of the believer. The position of the believer is whenever there's an opportunity, we take advantage of that. We don't wait. We look for opportunities to help and assist. Then there is the position of the hypocrites. Those who, whenever they see opportunity, they discourage other people. We find some people, subhanAllah, they always discourage other people. Why? Because they don't want for these people to be, you have to live a happy life, live a better life. And then we have those who are just whiners. They don't help, then they discourage, they only just give instructions and just talk and talk and talk, and honestly, it leads nowhere. So if you're going to do something, then you need to do less talking and just create ideas. Look around, search, and then provide some ways for the people to help with, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Also, whenever you try to help others, keep in mind that you're doing it only for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, first and foremost. Some of us, and many of us perhaps, when we get emotionally charged, we want to just yell and talk and do things so that we can feel better. That's all. It's not about you feeling better. It's about them, their situation to become better. So sometimes you're going to still have to have that kind of energy, have to have that pain in your heart while you're doing it. But you're doing it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we do that, the second thing I want you to think about is that I want you to be realistic as well. Let's be realistic. Some of us living in this country over here, live in this society, we also have our own lives. We have our families to take care of. We have our business to take care of. So we have many things around us. No one is asking you to give up everything and just give everything for these people so they can survive and you start begging other people. No one is asking you to do that. You need to be realistic in the capacity that you can. And again, like I said, in this society, there is so much, wallah, you could do. So much you could do in the right way, in the legal way as well. Just make sure to look for it and ask. And inshallah, you will be guided by Allah Azza wa Jal. In addition to that, I want you to not just to kind of spread yourself so thin into different ideas and different things that you could do. Focus on something you can be the best at. So if you're good in social media, make sure to create campaigns and help other people. If you're good as a public speaker, go out there and bring that issue out to the public. If you're good in collecting donations and so on, go with some of these organizations and help them out. Bring the money, not necessarily your money. Other people want, so you can assist these people, inshallah, and help them out. In whatever capacity you can, just look for these ideas and search something that's your best at, inshallah ta'ala, and do it. And finally, when you start something, I want you to be continuous with it. When you start something, you be continuous, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he asked about the best of good deeds, what did he say? أحب الأعمال إلى الله أدومها وإن قل. The best of those good deeds to Allah Azza wa Jal are the most continuous, even if they were little. Little things you could do, one post at a time, one video at a time, one statement, one word, one lecture, $1 at a time. And it's continuous and regular, better than just going with an outburst for a few days just so you could feel better and then just everything stops after that. No one can tell me this day you can't do anything. And I want you, before you leave from this khutbah, inshallah ta'ala, to keep in mind something you will do right when you finish this khutbah, while you leave from this masjid. One thing, think about it, that you could do, inshallah tabaraka wa ta'ala, before Asr Salah, that you will achieve in order to help these people in the best way, in the right way, inshallah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allahumma allimna ma yanfa'na, wa anfa'na bima allamtana, innaka anta al-alim al-hakim. Allahumma aati nufusana taqwaha, wa zakki anta khayru man zakkaha, أنت وليها مولاها. عباد الله، إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. وارض اللهم عن خلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي، وعن سائر الصحابة أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. وأقم الصلاة.